Hi, I'm now live. It's Sunday. It's time for Saxophone Sunday. Here we go. Today's all about this little beauty. This is my tenor. This is one of the loves of my life. I've had this saxophone for 23 years. 23 years. Come on, play something for us. Okay, all right then. Shall we crack on? Right, so I had a couple of requests from you, so I thought I'd play one of those. So why don't we kick off? Don't know what I've done here. Why don't we kick off with a couple of standards and then we'll move on to something else, and then I'll tell you all about my lush tenor. Weirdly, and I will talk about this later, but I've got an alto which is the same make and model. I blooming hate it. Isn't that weird? I'll play you some alto another day, but today's all about the tenor because we love it so. Right, let's just pop this up a bit. Play anything. Okay. I will. We are not messing around today, are we? Right, what key am I doing things in? Okay. Right, let's have a little bit of the Nearness of You because it's so beautiful. And somebody asked me for this. As per, I've not written down who asked for it, but if you asked for this, this is for you. This is the Nearness of You. Song. And also, being a singer, I'm always singing the words to myself as I'm playing it, and I just think that kind of helps get the mood of it across. I hate it. It's like one of my absolute bugbears in life, when especially My Funny Valentine, but when people just like play it as a bebop tune, it's like, do you not know what this is about? This is one of the most beautiful songs that has ever been written. Just think about the lyrics. Right, let's have a little look what you're saying. Thank you, I'm glad you like my sound and my feel. That's, oh, it makes me so happy. Perfect feel, not quite perfect technique, but I do appreciate it. Thank you ever so much. Just what a lovely tune, hey? So, tell you a little bit about my tenor. So I got this when I was 15. It's a Selmer Super 80 Series 2. If you're super geeky, it was made in the, 90s, like mid to late 90s. So let's properly geek out, shall we? I know that I'm going to lose some of you, but that's okay. Somebody's asked me to talk all about this, and so I'm going to tell you all about it. So Selmer Super 80 Series 2 tenor, mid to late 90s. I use this sling, which I've just recently had actually. It's a Rico. The reason I use this sling is because it just has a hook on it. And I know some of you are gonna go, but that's not safe, it's not safe. But the reason is that because I sing as well, I often have to just like chuck it on the stand really quickly. It's not the pale moon that excites me. So that's why I've got to have this little quick release thing. Can I play John Coltrane? Not really. Not really that good. I can play some Coltrane, but I've got a little list today. I'm going to write Coltrane on my list for next time. Okay, so this is my mouthpiece, which I just adore. Again, this is another one of those things that I'm just never going to get rid of. It's probably disgusting. It's always got lipstick on it. This is a Berg Larsen Ebonite mouthpiece, Berg Larsen are kind of known for their metal mouthpieces and their really bright sound, and they're a lot thinner than this, but this is quite nice and big, and it's got a nice big chamber, and this is the ligature that came with it, so this is what I use. And then the reed, it's disgusting again. Whenever I take my sax to Headwind in Bristol, they tell me off about my reeds because they are just gross. But this is a Van Doren Java. Is it? No, it's a Van Doren Jazz reed. I'm not really that fussy about reeds, I have to say, because I started off as a sax player and I was super into it, and I used to just get like massively geeky about stuff. But since not doing that as much and being a singer now, I kind of just stick to what I know, which is Super 80, Selma Super 80 Series 2 tenor, Berg Larsen Ebonite mouthpiece, Van Doren Jazz reed. I'm thinking about changing the reeds because, as you'll see in a minute, I'm getting a bit of, because I'm playing a bit more and my lip is getting a bit stronger, I'm getting, like, it's, you need a stronger reed at the heart, the kind of better your lip is, I suppose. So I'm not getting my top notes properly, so I think I might need to go up a level. And the last thing, really important, which people will forget when they're buying a saxophone, is stand. You need somewhere to put it when you're not playing it that's really secure. This is a Hercules stand, and I love their microphone stands. So that's why I use a Hercules. I'm not so sure about this one. The reason that I got it, hang on, let me put my sax down somewhere else. The reason that I got this one is it's folding, and it folds up really small, and it goes into the top pocket on my tenor case. But, and it's also got this thing where it holds onto your sax for you. So you put your saxophone on there and watch. It kind of grabs it and holds it. So that's really nice. We are properly geeking out today, aren't we, about saxophones, but it's Saxophone Sunday. And then the last couple of things. This is probably really old fashioned as well, but I use a pad saver. And lastly, but certainly not leastly, this is a Protec case, Protec tenor case, which again, I've had this for a really long time and it's worked wonders. The only thing I'd change is that it's only got one shoulder strap, and I would definitely like to change that for a rucksack, especially having a bit of a dodge shoulder. But apart from that, I'm really kind of happy with everything. So there we go, that's me geeking out about saxophones. Well, that saxophone in particular. Right, so a couple more things. Someone asked me, let's play some more. Okay, someone asked me to play this as well. I recorded this actually on this. This is the Positive, this is the last album that I made, full album. And this is, it's standards and new standards. And this is called Lullaby of Birdland by George Shearing, who's just amazing. This is it on tenor. I just don't know what key I'm playing anything in today. Let's try that. Thank you. Lullaby of Birdland, everybody. So somebody asked me this morning what made me start playing, or when, yeah, why did I start playing tenor? So basically, I was a netball player. That was what I loved to do until I was 11. And then when I was 11, I moved schools. I was always small, quite small, 5'4½". Half is very important. I was always small, but I could play netball. I was quite quick, so I played sort of in the middle. And I moved schools when I was 11 to a school that there wasn't, I mean, it was a lovely school, but really there wasn't much going on, except for there was a big band, which was amazing. And until that point, I'd played the piano really quite badly. I wasn't really that into music, but you know, what else is a girl to do when you're kind of in rural Shropshire and you've moved to a new school, there's nothing to do. So I started singing with the big band, and because I'm small, I was the cute one and everyone else was sort of in their, you know, mid to late teens, I guess. And so I joined the big band, but because I was only singing one song, it got really boring really quickly. So I, in concerts, so I said to the band leader, can I play an instrument? And he's like, no, you're fine. Just stick to the singing. You can do more songs later. And I was like, I don't know, this is a bit dull, isn't it? It's a bit boring. So I borrowed my friend Carly's clarinet. I took it home that night. And then when I came in the next day, and I stole the music. I mean, God, it's so naughty. I stole all the music and took it home that night. And then the next day, because I could already play the recorder and I could read music, I could play most of the music for the big band. So I kind of said to my the band leader, look, you know, I just want to show you this, like I can play now. And he's like, oh great, okay, well done, all right, you're in. So I was playing clarinet, kind of glancing across at the girls with the saxophones and being like, oh, they're really cool, aren't they? So again, a friend of mine had a sax. I was like, do you think, could I just borrow that tonight and then bring it back tomorrow? She's like, yeah, sure. Again, nicked all the music and came back, and I could play, I think I learnt to play the alto solo on In the Mood. So again, I went up to him, this is like a few months later, and I was like, oh, hi, just to let you know, I can play the saxophone now. And he's like, oh, Biggins, could you just please stop it? So that was it, I was on alto. And then when I grew a bit, I went to tenor. And that's how I started playing sax. That's a very long-winded story, wasn't it? But there we go. So new school, new band, was a bit bored, started playing sax. So one last tune for you. Oh, I need to let you know what's happening this week. So I'm going to try and do these live sessions every other day. If there's anything you want to ask me, then ask away, because this is your time. So just ask. Those are questions that people have kind of sent in the last couple of days. If you want to send me a question for Tuesday is going to be Turntable Tuesday. Yes. Very exciting. I'm finding it quite hard because the kids are off at the moment to do the pictures and do the writing for my Instagram posts. So I thought this way, we're here for like 20 minutes. I get to actually talk to you, which is lovely. And I'm still, you know, I'm still playing for you and still talking about records. So Tuesday is Turntable Tuesday. I'm going to pick two albums to chat about. I don't know what they're going to be yet, but if you have seen my Turntable Tuesdays on my feed, have a look and see if there's any albums that you want me to talk about. And if you do, then let me know and I will on Tuesday. In the meantime, I'm going to play you one more tune, unless anybody has any questions. If you have a question, just jump on in and let me know. Otherwise, this is something which snuck in just at the last minute. And I said, oh no, I've got an ad. I don't want a Google ad, thanks. Well, heck, why does that always happen?
So hang on. Homeschoolers,
have we changed?
Home
Aloners, no, it's the right thing. Sorry about this, everybody. Just give me a sec. Because what I'm going to do is... Oh, bloody hell. Sorry. Ah, there we go. Okay, cool. I'm going to play you a tune which someone asked for earlier. Torb, you're so distracting. I've just asked if anyone has any questions, and Andy, who's downstairs, has said, Hunter, who's three, asked, can I have some pudding? Yes, Hunter, you can have some pudding, but you need to get your dad to sort it. All right, Mama's busy. Sozza. I'll be down in 5 minutes. So someone asked me earlier for this tune, or not for this tune, actually, but for some Eric Clapton. and how could I say no? So this is a tune which, this is a transcription of a solo which was recorded by a sax player called Joshua Redman. It's lovely, lovely player. And again, I think this is from the mid 90s and it's Tears in Heaven. So it's Joshua Redman playing Tears in Heaven, and I'm gonna play along with him. It's probably get loads of things wrong, but you know what? We're all friends here, aren't we? So who cares, everybody? Who cares? Here we go, a bit more sax. I did used to know this solo really, really well. That's my caveat, here we go. I mean, I just think it's wonderful. A couple of blips there, but you know what? I've not played it in a really long time. Thanks so much for requesting that. That was really nice to do. I really enjoyed that. Okay, so sounds good. Thanks, Pito Sax. Peto Sax? Pito Sax? And my mum joined. Hi, Ma. That slightly put me off. But lovely. So this is what's gonna happen. I'm gonna let this go on to my stories, and then tomorrow I'm gonna upload it and it will be on Insta, YouTube, Facebook, all that kind of shiz. And then Tuesday, we're gonna start again and we're gonna do Turntable Tuesday. So join me, 1:30 British Standard Time on Tuesday, and I'll talk about two of my favorite vinyl records. I'll see you then. Thanks so much for joining in. Bye.